this episode of Customizing the Clone Wars with your host, Todd Peak as Peak-OB1 and Brian Fulton as Darth Daddy, with special guest, Elias Fulton. What will our heroes have in store for this installment? What wisdom can they provide? Let's watch and listen.
Well, hello once again, friends. This is another awesome episode of Customizing the Clone Wars. My name is Chad Peak, a.k.a. Peak-OB1 from Peak-OB1 Custom Creations on Facebook. Along with me, I have my co-hosts. They are Brian and Elias Fulton from the Customs for the Kid Blogspot. How are you guys doing?
Great. We're doing all right.
We're doing again.
Are you getting that note, that blue box up in the upper right-hand corner?
No.
Oh, it's saying Hangouts on Air is going away later this year for quick streaming. Try youtube.com/webcam, but I mean, that won't help us for what we do.
Yeah.
But I just got my first warning that Hangouts on Air is going away.
Yeah. We're doing everything we can to try to get the rest of this out to you guys. We love it. We love the Clone Wars. You know, we're so excited for the new season to come up, right?
Oh yeah, for sure. Now they're saying, I'm starting to see more people saying that 2020 is when Clone Wars is coming and not when the Disney streaming service launches in November.
That's what I'm hearing too. I've heard mixed things, you know. It's going to be available right away. It's not going to be available. It won't be available till next year, which I guess is fine, but I really want it to happen sooner than later, right?
Oh, for sure. Definitely.
It looks good. It looks really good. The animation looks all soft. What do you think about it so far? You saw the preview from Celebration, right?
Yeah, there is a little bit of a difference, but visually, but nothing that I care about, you know, that would turn me off or anything of that nature.
Yeah, it's softer, a little bit more Disney-fied, right? A little bit sweeter in the face and whatnot in Ahsoka.
Yeah, thing. You notice it the most in Anakin.
Yeah, you really do. But what I really like is he has that, you know, he has longer hair.
Yeah, he has that Episode 3 look going on.
Exactly. And we're going to get a little bit of that in today's episode, I should say. I don't know why I keep saying tonight. middle of the afternoon. It's a great day. Always a great day to talk about Clone Wars. Yes, we are talking, this is episode 70. We're talking about the Onderon arc in its entirety. Man, this could have been a made-for-TV movie all by itself, right? Four episodes. I have the opinion that it could have been three episodes. It really, you know, I think it went on one episode a little too many. How about you?
Yeah, I mean, maybe you could have cut out that episode where Saw goes to rescue the king, maybe.
Yeah.
Or somehow condensed it, but I mean, overall, I like the characters that they introduced in the episode, and I love that, you know, while we were introduced to Saw Gerrera in this arc, we got to see him later on in Rogue One, and we got to see a character come from the Clone Wars into the live-action films. Which I really like that idea.
I absolutely love that too. You know, when they pull things from the Clone Wars, it just makes my brain melt. You know, we saw it in Solo. We see even in Rebels. You know, it was exciting to see these people carry on to Rebels also and hear their stories. You know, especially with Saul Gerrera.
This is really like a key event in his life. I mean, I would say this is maybe the event that radicalized them and turned them into someone who go a little further than what the rebellion was willing to do. And I would say this is what kind of made him an extremist.
Right. I want to say too, if you follow Legends at all, you know, the old stuff, you know, the old EU, mm-hmm. I want to say they turned him into the Garm Bell Iblis, you know, the character that they used to use as the father of the rebellion, you know. They never really put I would say they never really put Bail Organa as the father of the rebellion. There was always this other guy, this other senator. And I think they kind of transferred that into this character, into Saul Gerrera. You know, they're not the same character by any
means. Yeah, but there's characteristics that they kind of borrowed. And almost like you get elements of Starkiller and Ezra Bridger.
Exactly. I thought for sure they were going to turn Ezra into Starkiller.
Yeah, it was looking that way for a while, especially when you had that season where Ezra looked like he was kind of going dark for a while there.
Exactly. And that's cool if they want to do that. You know, they want to kind of redefine the story. You know, you get a lot of people that are like, oh, we want the book, you know, and the people that don't really like the new Star Wars, the Disney Star Wars. And honestly, when they do change things so dramatically, I think they're not trying to, you know, tear apart the fandom or anything. They're just really trying to give you something new and inventive, you know, without using these things, you know.
Yep.
Anyway, I'm rambling on, but this is what Star Wars is really all about. You know, it's the Star Wars, you know, the Star Wars. You see kind of these insurgents, right? And that was a weird thing at the time too, back in October of 2012, right? We were talking about Bin Laden and like, was it after Bin Laden? Would you say, how would you say
that? Maybe, what, 10 years after? Because I think it was 2001, 9/11.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Well, maybe.
I don't remember because that was my neighborhood.
Yeah, it was something else that they were kind of connecting it to, whatever was going on in modern times. You know, they were talking about insurgencies.
Yeah.
Right?
Basically they're like kind of proxy wars where you have the Republic and the separatists not fighting directly, but like
influencing separate parties that would fight each other.
Yeah.
Right.
So they're, you know, and kind of like shadow politics.
Yeah. And I think what they did in this is that they did that similar thing where they were like, well, we're bogged down. You know, the Jedi's are bogged down. I think that's what it says. It says, with the Republic bogged down fighting the separatists, Anakin suggests training rebels to lead the insurgencies on a number of worlds. So I think they went to Saul. They went to, and we found Lux too, right?
In that
episode. He ended up on Onderon. I guess we learn a little bit more about him, and they test this out, right? They have to train these guys, so they actually go there.
And didn't Lux share information that his mother, Amina Bonteri, represented Onderon?
Yes, she did. That's where he grew up, and that's probably why he ended up there, because after his several failed attempts to, you know, just kind of get his way, you know, he was kind of one of those people that kind of got sucked up into the war, right? Wasn't sure what side.
Yeah, he had, I think this is him almost taking a step back, because initially he was like, I'm joining Death Watch and, you know, I'm going to team up with them to take Dooku out. And he had like grand plans. And this is him kind of taking a more mature, measured approach and saying like, well, these are people that my mother represented and, in government, and I have a duty to help, you know, help these people and protect these people. This is, you know, he felt some kind of obligation, and it was something that I think that he was capable of doing, where trying to kill a Sith Lord and teaming up with terrorists, terrorist government organizations, those were like lofty goals. So this is him kind of like saying, all right, thinking more realistically, maybe.
Yeah, I know. And he already was friends with these people, or that he aligned with, I'm pretty sure. He was even starting to, you know, have a relationship with Steela, right?
There's something budding there, mutual interest.
Got interesting. They actually introduced like almost like a love triangle dynamic between Ahsoka, Steela, and Saw. Or not Saw. Lux.
Right.
We don't need any more Luke and Leia.
That was awful.
Well, I think you're thinking that because they do that kind of that dynamic, you know, when Ahsoka comes in, and we'll talk about it here.
She
didn't know right away that they were brother and sister.
Yeah. But like she's interested in Lux, and like Lux and Steela have been like together there for a while, and they already kind of have like a developed relationship. And Ahsoka is all like staring at him like, okay, I don't like what's going on here. Get away from my mans.
Yep, exactly. All right, let's get into this because we have a lot to talk about. We're doing the entire thing. This is, like I said, this is episode 70 of our show. This is Customizing the Clone Wars. If you haven't seen our show, there's 69 other episodes right behind it. We talk about this show in length. We dissect it, and we make the toys that we only wish we had, right? And we're going to talk about a few tonight.
For some reason, when it came to Season 5, we didn't really get a lot of action figures.
I don't think we got any.
Maybe the 501st Trooper?
Maybe.
That was it, though.
But, yeah, I mean, we definitely didn't get characters like the ones in this arc that we would have liked to have had. So what we've done, we've gone and made those action figures, and we're going to go through and kind of tell you guys how you could go about making some of your own.
Exactly. I think Hasbro did a good job. That's the company that makes the toys. The 3¾-inch scale is what we focus on the show. I think they did a good job. They ended up with about 200+.
It was, I think, 300 if you counted like repack version and battle packs and stuff like that.
Okay. Yeah. I don't think I've taken an official count. I tried to, you know.
I did on Jedi Business, but I don't know how thorough that is. I only did it Friday.
Yeah.
Yeah, I did it on Friday, just like for ha-has.
So close to 300 then.
Yeah.
Okay. Very good.
But like I said, some of those are repacks. That showed up at like, you know, maybe they were on a single card initially and then were released in maybe a 2-pack or a battle pack or, you know, some other iteration later. So you could shrink that number down, but generally
it probably is closer to 300 than 250.
Yeah. Here we are. We want more. I'm getting close to 400 that I've made. Just for the Clone Wars, you know, and yeah. You guys are probably up there too. You're getting close to. Are you getting close to 100?
Yeah, probably getting close to 100. Maybe you were at like around 80 or.
That's impressive. I mean, that's our point that we're trying to make. It's not that we're like, whoa, look what we did or anything. We look at all this stuff, these unique characters that Mr. Dave Filoni made and his group, of course, and. They're just so amazing. They're so creative and inventive and exciting, you know, and that's why we want to make this. That's why we want to do this. So let's get on with the show, shall we? Let's get into our first fortune cookie of the day. I have all of them together, so we will look at them all at once. So here's the first one. This is from A War on Two Fronts. It says, fear is a malleable weapon.
That is very true. That even relates to something that Russo ISC, the investigator droid, later in Season 5 says, fear makes the most trusting individuals irrational.
Oh, man. I love that guy, by the way. I'm glad you brought him up. We will definitely be seeing him because... he's one of my favorite characters from he's played off of Season 5 or not CSI Season 5. Oh my gosh, I'm all over the place. But yeah, I love that idea that we bring in these fortune cookies like this where they'll actually bring them up in different episodes, which is so cool. So that was the first one, and then I'm going to move on to the next one. And like I said, I'm going to do them all in a row. And the next one says, to seek something is to believe in its possibility. What do you think about that one?
Hope.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Exactly. And an idea that if you don't like how it's going, you know, maybe seek out something different, something that you can do to maybe change, you know, whatever's going on. Because I think they aligned with the separatists, and that this was not what they really wanted, right? Onderon didn't really want this.
I think what happened was King Dendup was like faced with a choice. Both sides came to him and they were like, all right, you can ally with either of us. And he was like, I'm not going to ally with either of you because you both suck. And then the separatists just showed up and took it from him without him letting them, pretty much. They just invaded and took it.
Yeah, yeah. They put all the battle droids there and kind of set up a whole police force.
Yeah, I'll tell you something I didn't like in the later seasons, and this is just purely my opinion. What you just said, you don't really see the separatists kind of beating people up, you know, like they did with the Lerman, right? You know, let's ransack this dung heap, you know. I remember that, you know, you don't really see the people, they didn't really seem oppressed, right?
Not in the city, but as you see, when you have the rebels on the outskirts in the jungles or wherever they were hiding out, as soon as they were located, they opened fire, you know, the separatist army they started opening fire.
Yeah, because they acted like they were terrorists, right?
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. So the next one we're going to go into, and by the way, the other fortune cookie was from Front Runners. And the third one is called The Soft War. And this says, struggles often begin and end with the truth. What do you think about that one?
I wish that were true.
Well, it sort of does. Like, think about, like, any argument, like, something happened. That's the truth. That's how it is. And that initiated a sort of, like, conflict. And throughout trying to fix that, like with the conflict, there's lots of lies, deception, and things that really like kind of taint the original motive. And by the end, when things are solved, someone with a clear head was able to refocus on the initial motive and solve the problem.
I always think that history is written by the winner. So
yeah,
I mean, if the winner wins and they're not the best, you know, they may not want the truth to be out there.
They can cover it up.
Yeah, they can cover it up. So,
yeah, and I think this comes down to what was the commander? It was General Tandon. You know, I think he was conflicted a lot. You know, in the and once he finally learned the truth, I think he was
one of the cooler characters.
What's that?
He was one of the cooler characters.
Yeah, when he was introduced, he was like very like black and white, and he saw them as terrorists.
So he was pragmatic.
He was.
Yeah. Yeah, I hear you. Totally hear you. And then the last one, we'll get into kind of the screen captures, and we'll finally get into our first custom tonight, folks. Tipping points. That's the last one. It says, disobedience is a demand for change. What do you think about that one?
That definitely describes the protest movements.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think they just wanted their world to not be, taken over by someone else. You know, it's a strong.
Yeah, and he seemed like a dictator, I would say.
King Rash?
Yeah.
Yeah, that guy was.
He was a puppet, but he was a dictator.
Yeah, he was being controlled by Dooku, and I don't think the guy even knew it. You know, he was kind of bored. You know, he was always like leaning back in his chair. Like,
oh yeah, completely. He just wanted the luxury lifestyle that came along with the power.
Exactly. Exactly. Well, here we go. We're going to get into it. You see these insurgencies or these rebels, essentially. You know, Anakin's correcting everybody. They come to the Jedi Council for help. Immediately, they're going to what they know is the best people to help solve their problems, right? And of course, you know, as Qui-Gon Jinn would always say in The Phantom Menace, I can't fight a war for you. I'm only here to to serve you and protect you. But these guys are just like, please help us, you know? So as they get there, as they, you know, get their plea out, Anakin's like, this is a great idea. You know, let's do this.
Yeah. He was very eager.
Yeah. And you can see that they've already had their army placed here in, you know, around the city and whatnot. So,
yeah, they basically had that city on lockdown completely.
Oh, for sure. Yeah. And then here we go. We're going to get into some of our first characters, our customs. And those are going to be, well, you want me to talk about mine first, or do you want to start with one of the two of these characters? These lovely characters.
I think most of our pictures have them together, so do yours first, because if we do ours, then I think it'll, like, we'll do end up doing both, like, both of them might get exposed. Unless we do the work in progress.
Oh, that's fine. That's fine. I'll do mine first. Okay. This is a first-time reveal for today. There I go again, saying today, tonight, everything. One of these, at some point, this is my first time reveal. We have our Republic and our Jedi, and they go and they train these people. Right? They're just basically out in the forest, in the jungle, and they meet up with them. So they have to, the Jedi, that is, they have to take along Rex. Right? Oh, there's my Steela. I did her ages ago. Gosh, I can't recall. I think I did her back in, let's see. I don't know. It was a while back.
Probably a year ago, at least you started her, right?
Yeah, yeah. But this is one of the Rebels. I'll lead in with my Steela. I know you guys got a really great Steela. You want to take a look at, but once again, we use that awesome body, you know, that I use the Ara Sing again. It's always a great body to use because there's really not a lot to it. You know, she's like in a skin suit, you know, she hardly, you know, she hardly has, you know, anything, any type of armor on her. On her body and whatnot.
She has very thin features, so it makes her easy to customize because you can add without having to worry about how much you're taking away.
Yeah, I gotcha. Yeah, and most of it is just added pieces with Procreate. You know, I just added some Procreate here and there, and then the head I used, it was actually, can you guess what head that is?
That Adigalia?
It is. Yeah. Definitely.
Which Adigalia?
The
one that was on the
Jedi Council one.
Yeah, she's on the Jedi Council. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So what I did is I just grinded the whole head off. Basically. The whole headdress type of thing. And then I just did all that from scratch, whatnot. And then even with the gun, you know, that was a big gun.
I had to reduce that for him.
Yeah, Castus's gun. So I reduced it a little bit myself, but I still gave it a fairly large holster so that it could fit if I wanted to put it on her belt.
I totally forgot too. I kind of wanted to do like a little tutorial thing to show people how to shrink the gun down.
Yep.
And I forgot.
Yeah. So, So before I get into my other reveal tonight, we already discussed this whole dynamic with these three people, you know, that even Steela is a little bit jealous of Ahsoka, right? Because her and Lux have a friendship, right?
Yeah. They shoot each other glances.
I don't know. I think it is really beyond friendship because even Lux and Ahsoka, like, they know that they like each other. Like, they just know that because of their lifestyles that they can't work, but they still, like, do have feelings for each other that they really, like, acknowledge throughout the course of the entire show.
Exactly. Yeah. I think he even says something like, if it wasn't for Ahsoka, I wouldn't be here. She's the reason I'm here, or something like that. So it turned out in the end that, they had a great friendship. They were pretty tight. I think everybody was rooting for them to be together, too, after that.
I like Lux overall. I mean, he had, like, I think he was very similar to Ahsoka in the sense that he was kind of not annoying, but like, you saw that immaturity in the beginning, and you got to see Lux mature throughout the seasons.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah, he grows, and he's got that Han Solo look. Man, I wish I could actually put one of them together at some point. But
I have the parts, and actually yesterday I was like, so you know what I want for my birthday? I want the Lux Ponseri from Onderon.
Yeah, totally, totally. So here they are in the jungle, and they have to be trained. They have to be trained in. The first little section that I read, it said, amid rising tensions between Saul. No, I'm sorry. That wasn't it. It says, to test the idea, he travels with Obi-Wan and Ahsoka to Onderon, where rebels are fighting a separatist-aligned king. The three Jedi work to teach the techniques of war and the art of leadership. You know, so they have to go there and really get these rebels organized, in a sense, right?
Yep.
And what better way to do that is to take Rex with them, right?
Yep.
So this is going to lead into the reveal I was wanting to do right before I my Steela. So I decided to do tonight. I decided to do Onderon Rex or combat. Yay. That's so cool. Yeah, so I decided that this is the one I wanted to do, and I'm guessing you can pretty much see the body that I used.
That is beautiful.
That's a really good idea.
Yeah, it's that Obi-Wan again. It's that Obi-Wan we use all the time.
That's awesome.
Ah, thanks, man. Yeah, and what's great about this is we have so many creative people in the community, and they share with us their parts, their different types of things that they use. I think I used a head that you guys had molded for me, a Rex head. It was just it wasn't a head off the actual character per se. I think we had a mold and cast that you had done for me, and
I think I molded the Rex head from with the soft comma and the one that had the blast mark on his chest.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I should be able to start making more of those again soon.
Yeah, so sometimes, you know, you can pull from friends. You can pull from what people share with you. I think the holster is what you're seeing there. They were even from our friend from Camino Casting. He had sent those to me. As a little gift, and I appreciate that very much. And did you notice what's in his hand there?
Oh yeah, thermal detonator.
Yeah, I've done this once before. I actually pulled that from the Boba Fett helmet.
Oh, the one that's on the inside, right? The one that splits that comes with Mace Windu.
Yeah, I know it's a little bit rough on the back of it. You know, it's not necessarily complete because it's actually laying in there and whatnot. But it's a really great way to, you know, cheat it a little bit. Cheat a droid popper, right?
Yeah, now what kind of backpack does Rex actually wear for that episode?
It's really interesting. It's like I actually don't have a shot of the backpack that I did, but it's really this crazy kind of this. It's a combination of a little bit of everything, okay. You know. It's just a field backpack, and I actually you can see kind of on the back that it has the kind of the
like a Boba Fett jet, right?
The Boba Fett jets on it. What I decided to use once again from our buddy Camino Casting, he did the ARC Trooper, yep. The ARC Trooper backpack. And that's what I decided to use, and I applied the stormtrooper detonator to the top of it, and then I added two of the rocket jets from a Boba Fett backpack. So, you know, I'll try to get a picture, and I'll share it on my page. That way you can see the backpack as well. But he's 14 points, or no, he's not 14 points. He's, you know, doesn't have the ankle joints, unfortunately. But I think he turned out well.
Yeah, he looks awesome.
Yeah, the hat is completely sculpted. That's not you could have probably used like an Imperial officer hat or whatever, but I wanted to add that little element of the, you know, what we will eventually see Rex wear all the time, you know, that kind of that Endor helmet, right?
Yep.
Yeah. So this is
my look. Really good.
Thanks, man. Yeah, it turned out really nice, and once again, I used that that OB1 body. You know, I think there was a point in time where we were able to get that OB1 body for like super cheap, right? I mean,
it was like 10 for like $8, or it was some crazy sale on those.
Yeah, some overseas company was selling them. I don't know how they got a hold of them, but they looked like they were factory, right? And insanely cheap, because but they're great, right? They're great to use pretty much on tons of things. I have like three other characters that I'm working on just utilizing this body alone.
But yeah, it is a great body. I've used it several times myself.
It's
one of the better ones out there.
Yeah. But so that was my Rex, and he tries to teach them basically to develop their skills, you know, to sneak up on these people and get an advantage on the Separatist, right? Yep. And during the training, right, Anakin notices something, doesn't he?
Oh yeah, he notices Ahsoka getting a little unbalanced,
distracted.
Yeah,
she's young and she's looking all, you know, starry-eyed and whatnot. He's like, "What's going on?" Because he sees it in himself, you know, and so he's
getting jealous of Steela.
Yeah, he picks it up right away, and he's like, "Hey, snap out of it, man!"
Yeah,
and whether you like this guy or not, it doesn't matter. Let's keep it together, right? So I jumped a little bit. They ended up finding their location. They found the location of where they were at, and they had their first little dry run. They decide to try to sneak into the city. And this is the first time, too, we're seeing cloaks, you know, cloaks on them in a significant way, right?
Yeah, where they actually can move and they're not like a statue.
Yeah. They definitely had advancements in the show, in the animation and whatnot. And they make it into the city. And what's great about this is this little wagon that they're on or whatever, it almost looks like that thing that they're flying in the Rise of Skywalker, that kind of that speeder. Very similar.
Finn is in, right?
What's that?
The one that Finn and C-3PO are going to be in with Poe?
Right.
Yep.
I'll bet you they make something like that, or they should, right? They should.
That would be nice if they did.
Yeah, speeder or something. You know, there's always these accessories and elements that should go along with the figures. That's why we mainly focus on 3 3/4 inch, because we just we love the originality of that idea. You know, that happened from so long ago. You know, they developed it over time. You know, where you have 3 3/4 inch figures, you have accessories, you have beast assortments, you have everything that kind of makes up your play experience or your collecting experience, right?
They need to do some more revisitations on the beast packs.
Oh God, I know, and even accessory packs and whatnot. I know you've seen my space cats that I've been doing. You know, and folks, I'm working on them. I'm getting them out. I will make sure I get some stuff finished and completed for those. But I dig accessories, right?
I wish they did like another creatures line. Like they could do like your space cat. The Convor would be another good one. Yeah, there's a lot of cool creatures that they easily could add.
Yeah, even little droids too. I was going to try to finish up that little probe droid that they have in this, because they played a significant role in finding the rebels out in the jungle. Even those would be a really awesome kind of a little piece that can go along with a figure, right?
I prefer that to blue or black dice.
Yeah, exactly. You know, forget the games. Forget the games. Just, make some needed accessories, right?
Yep.
And this is of course the king. You know, the king at the time. And he's ticked that they're still succeeding. You know, and he's failing. So he's getting worried. And here they are. They're deciding to do what? They're going to take out the power grid, right?
Yep. That way the droids can't get recharged, and that would give them an advantage because it would cause a situation where the separatists would lose their army.
Because the droids can't recharge.
Right. And they definitely succeed.
By far one of the most epic explosions in the show.
I know, and it has kind of like an EMP, kind of an electromagnetic pulse kind of going out. It doesn't affect any of the droids, does it, or does it? It's kind of...
Well, the droids are fine. They're just like, we can't recharge now, and...
Right. So...
brought them to a literal standstill.
Yeah, and they get their first victory. And we had found out in that first episode after they got into the city that Rex, Anakin, and Obi-Wan, they actually left. Their job was done. But Ahsoka stayed behind to hopefully, you know, still continue to lead them in the right direction, right? And honestly, I think this episode was a developmental point of reasoning for her too, don't you think?
Oh, for sure.
Yeah, like later on, she basically becomes this, you know, later on, like in Rebels I'm talking about. As her life goes on, because as we know, she leaves the Jedi Order, and you gotta wonder, you know, well, how is she gonna make herself useful, or does she even need to make herself useful? But I think episodes like this kind of shaped her, right?
Yeah, oh, there's one of my favorite. Killarney, yeah. Man, that is like one character I really wish got made into a toy.
Yeah, and did you know that the voice of Killarney, did you know he's a famous voice? Do you know which voice Killarney is?
No.
He's actually the voice of Grimlock, you know, from Transformers.
I don't know Transformers well at all. Transformers came out like right when I stopped playing with toys.
Yeah, he's the Tyrannosaurus Rex.
Okay.
You know, the on the Autobots. Anyway, just a fun little fact. And I even think the General Tandon is actually the guy that the Optimus Prime voice.
Oh, that's so cool.
Yeah. So what you're seeing here is you're seeing Dooku kind of punishing this guy, basically saying, you're no good. You know, you're worthless.
Yeah, that whole thing was kind of like something that backfired. Like King Rash was like, we can take this loss and make it work for us. We can have him send us more droids. So I still control the entire city and I have more means to oppress the people.
Yeah.
And kind of backfired on him. Dooku was like, all right, you can't rule by yourself. I'll send someone here to do it for you.
Yeah, and he sends something pretty interesting. You know, you were just talking about him, Killarney. Killarney is interesting because he's a what is he? He's a super tactical droid.
Yeah.
So he's a step above the tactical droid, I would assume.
Yeah, and this is his first time that we've seen him, and he's going to actually live out the Clone Wars also, which is very interesting. You know, he carries on also into Rebels, man. If you haven't seen Rebels yet, man, you really have to. If you love the Clone Wars, it makes it that much more interesting when you come across these characters that that you've seen in the past. It's just kind of like a giant Star Wars history unfolding, right?
Yeah.
And this is another one we've talked about in length a bunch of times, you know, and that's holographic characters. You know, how many times, how easy would it be to just make a character, then make it a hologram, right?
Yeah, we've done it before.
Yeah.
It's been a while.
Yeah. And of course, they're using these just to kind of you know, get the people to rise up and see the mistakes that these rulers are making, right? They want to get it back to normal. They want to get it back to what it used to be. And so we also see here, this is King Dendup.
Yep.
And he's the actual guy they would rather have in office.
Yeah, he was the original king, the one that decided not to side with the Republic or the Separatists. So the Separatists took control. They threw him in a jail cell, which you just saw over there on Chad's screen.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And basically, King Rash is always like, stop the attacks. You need to like stop telling these people to like rebel against the Separatist opposition. And he was like, well, you have me inside of a prison cell. I can't communicate with the outside world. What you're dealing with is what the people actually want. If you want the attacks to stop, then stop the droid occupation. This is outside of my control.
Yeah. And that's how he is with Rash too. He's like hands off. He's hands off. He's like, I'm not controlling this, you know, and it makes him mad. It makes him mad. And what does he do? You know, he tortures Saul. He tries to do everything they can to get them all to stop. But you want to take this point in time to talk about your customs?
Sure. Yeah, sure. Let's I'm just trying to see where they're. Okay. So I guess we'll start off with Saw. I'll give you a background on that. Okay. So this is kind of where he was when I first started. These are lower legs are Anakin. The head is Anakin. This centerpiece here is just a Clone War torso that's connected to the Quinlan Vos. It's the Quinlan Vos skirt, and then I ended up cutting out panels of flattened Procreate that I glued to the skirt in sections.
Yeah.
To like kind of build things up, and there's like a mix of green stuff, Procreate. The arms are also Quinlan Vos.
Legs too. Can it do the splits? Can it do the splits?
Yeah, he can do the, he has ball jointed hips, but because I'll kind of show you, because the panels have to like kind of build up over time. I had to add like the rim in there, and then there was a split in there, but it didn't look right, so I kind of glued it together. So he has restriction where he can't do like a full blown like split where his legs both out on both sides or even front to back, but he can do more than just have swivel hips.
Yeah.
So that's kind of like where he kind of went at when I finally finished the sculpt up and I primed them all in black and the head paint was started.
What was the head that you used?
The head was actually Anakin that's been heavily modified.
Oh, of course. Was the newer one where it was kind of like he had a wig on or did you just grind off the hair?
I think I grinded off. I definitely took the hair and I grinded it off.
And then he sent me home with the head at one point.
It's the Anakin that kind of looked like this. I added like a whole big forehead to it.
I had painted the face at this point. I took it home with me and just finished up the face paint job.
And then I went in later on and then painted the hair to like put the gold stuff in it. So that's kind of where he went on the work in progress build. I guess I'll probably go right into Steela's work in progress now.
Sure.
Yeah.
Sure. All right. So I used an Aura Sing for the torso, the upper arms and the head, and then the lower arms are Cato Parasiti, and from the thighs down. That's a adventure pad bay from the Clone Wars. And one of the problems with the Cato Parasiti arms was they were like really long. Cato Parasiti had very short upper arms and very long lower arms. So I took an X-Acto and I cut away the wrist and I drilled in deeper to shorten the arm.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah. Yep. And that's when this right here is when some of her hair was in. I kind of just rolled out a bunch of little like snakes of Procreate and I stuck them all on individually.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That was a lot of fun.
Yep. Sometimes you gotta,
you know.
Yeah. So your passion, right?
Yeah. So she's moving on a little bit more here. I added the armor onto the legs and
now you actually flattened out first and then cut.
Yes.
No. To keep the straight lines.
Oh well.
And then this top rim you actually sculpted into connect, this is, right?
This is a process here. So I took Abe's Fix It sculpt and I put an initial layer over both legs to cover what was initially there. And that's not just one edge that I blended in, like that's full Abe's going all the way down there. And then I took like a sheet of Procreate, a dried out sheet, and I cut out like long rectangles with like scissors.
Yep.
And I just placed them all there and I used wet Procreate and sculpted in these bars here to connect everything together.
Awesome. Yeah, I think for that gray pocket you're seeing there, I think I used just a GI Joe pocket. Every once in a while, I'll just kind of put, you know, an added pocket that already has been made.
Yeah.
Nice. And there we go. You got, there's an accessory I'm talking about. You know, check that out. That's awesome. The rifle I'm talking about.
Yes. This I was like really worried about because I was like, I've never seen a gun that has a perforated, like a barrel that's like got all like the holes in it. And then I thought to myself, think through all the characters in Star Wars and what their weapons looked like. And I thought, wow, that looks a lot like an IG-88 gun. And I did my research and it turns out it is an IG-88 gun. Yep. So I found an old Power of the Force IG-88 and I took the gun and I ended up adding this from I don't know what that was. That was just a little piece of something from fodder that I stuck on right here. And then I hid the seam with this fabric right here. That's hockey tape, yep. And I just put
some had a clip on too, right?
Yes, I did. I took that from a battle droid gun and just stuck it right there. But yeah, I'd say that if you want to make that rifle, the closest thing you'll find is a Power of the Force IG-88 gun.
Yeah, you added the front barrel with the the strap.
And on her head, her goggles are modified Hondo Anaka goggles. You just cut off.
Part, right? That's our favorite part, our favorite little accessory, right?
And they actually, they're completely the same. You just have to cut off the little ear things, so it's just the two lenses and the nose piece.
Yeah, right before you painted it, right?
Yeah, I think that's a completed sculpt. I sculpted on her little knife, her knee pad, I sculpted on separately, let dry, and then I stuck that on. But I'd say she's heavily modified and you're going to have to dedicate a lot of time to it because it looks nothing like the original piece. And also in some of the work in progress pictures, you'll notice her nose looks a little wider. When I was working, I noticed it looked a little too wide, so I trimmed it a little thinner and it looks more like her.
Was this the Aura Sing head?
Yep.
Oh, okay. Yeah, well, it looks awesome. Looks awesome. Great work.
So I guess we'll just share the finished.
Yeah, we have a picture of the finished together.
All right, so I'll get to that. And screen share. Okay, are they coming through now?
Yeah, they are.
Mm-hmm. All right, cool. All right, so this is the way they came out finished and all painted up.
What did you use to make his rocket launcher?
What
did that come from?
Draw? Was it called Trooper Draw?
That is one of those things where that came with only two clone troopers.
Yeah, was it bronze?
In the entire line. It came with Draw, and yep. It came with Jack. It came with Jack.
Oh, okay, that's who it was.
Yeah. So there's always these little things in the entire collection when it had its run. You know, there was like Savage Opress's lightsaber. You could really only get it with Savage Opress. You couldn't get it the second time around when they released him in the 3-pack, you know. And this that bazooka is the same way, right? It's just,
yeah, it's pretty hard to come by.
Yeah, it's hard to come by, which is kind of a bummer because it really looked nice. You know,
it's one of the cooler weapons, especially in this episode. Hondo brought a whole case full of them, so you know.
Exactly. Yeah, we get into a point. It gets pretty hairy in the show. You know, I think. Yeah, it's. We'll get to that point. Yeah, he brought a whole bunch of them, didn't he?
Yeah, that was actually an interesting part of the storyline because it talks about how the Jedi ended up kind of going through the black market to supply the Onderon army on the sly because it was like all off the books, all under the radar. Basically, a situation where if it got out into the public, it probably would have been a pretty juicy news story.
Yeah, I think Anakin, he shows up on Florum and Hondo's like, "Is that all I am to you, a delivery boy?" And he's like, no, I'm here because if I know I need to do something illegally, you're the person I go to." And Hondo's like, "Illegally? Ooh, juicy."
Yeah, he likes that. He is probably one of my favorite characters out of the Clone Wars, or he's become one.
I love Hondo. He's a lot of fun.
I was really excited to see that he's going to be at
Galaxy's Edge.
Yeah, and he's even got a 6-inch action figure, which that's something I didn't expect to see.
Yeah, I was pretty blown away. We saw that celebration. I was just like, ooh. I'm like, man, can you give it to us in 3 3/4 inch, please? You know?
Oh, I know. That would be heavenly if they did something like that.
Yeah. I would much prefer that, but those look amazing, man. Thanks for sharing those and all the work that you put into them. Really, really great. Really great stuff. They become kind of the insurgents of a inspiration for the galaxy, right? Because you're seeing our king here, Dendiv, and I guess back into the episode, we're seeing that they're going to kill him, right? They're going to execute him.
Yeah.
And he was like, make these people come forward. Make these people like Steela and Saul come forward. And they already had Saul captured, right? And then what's going to happen right here is pretty crazy, too. Another aspect, not only about, you know, Hondo bringing them guns and whatnot, but we also see something with the Jedi, right? Ahsoka intervenes, right?
Yeah.
She was actually about to, like, they put his head into the guillotine sort of thing, and she starts, like, going through the crowd. She gets her lightsabers out. She's like, all right, I'm ready. I'm about to stop this. And then that was when General Tandon ended up intervening himself, and she was like, all right, I'll sit back and let them take care of this because it seems that there's already intervention. So
yeah, but I think she does give it away that
she does.
That's, yeah, basically, I don't think Tandon was actually successful.
No,
and she
he
had
wasn't.
To intervene anyway.
Yeah, she was like, she's the Force. I think she didn't cause any damage, so like technically she didn't get super involved. She just kind of pushed everything out of the way and got them out.
Yeah, created a moment.
Yeah, but I think they knew at that point that this is trouble. This is trouble. The Jedi are aligning with the insurgents.
Yeah,
and of course Yeah, and Kalani sees this. He's the strategist. He's the one that's going to, you know, take this and learn from it in the world.
He starts rattling off statistics and,
yeah,
you know, basically what he comes up with, the data says, like, this is a wash. Let's get out of here.
Right, right.
Yeah, I think at one point when King Rash was, like, trying to figure out, like, what the Rebels' deal was, they actually had the yellow droid that shows up all throughout the Clone Wars. It shows up a bunch of times. They had that droid in that scene. So, yeah, that was a cool little cameo of the droid that shows up. I think it shows up in the Youngling arc. It shows up in Revival. They reused that asset kind of like they did the Poonzignot.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Yeah.
Do you have your yellow droid? You made that at one point, didn't you?
Yeah, I believe I did, but I don't actually have it in here. I didn't know. This is the R1M4, is it?
Hold on. It's R4M1.
Yeah, I didn't realize. I guess I didn't realize he was in there. He's in the temple, right?
The cat. Yeah, he was in the castle temple thing, and
King
Rash's.
Yeah, King Rash. When he asked about Steela, the droid was the one that projected like the file on Steela Gerrera.
Yeah. I did not know that. I must have skipped over it because I was just watching him the other night again, but. Yeah, it's great how they continue to use, you know, assets that they've had in the past. I was reading some of the trivia and whatnot, and they were going to have like this super decorated droid to, you know, project it. But they ended up running long with all the animation and whatnot, so that's why they used something that they already had.
Yeah, makes sense.
Yeah, but it was supposed to be like this super elaborate droid that they never got around to making. And I was pretty impressed with it too, because I was like, man, maybe I need to make that. I need to find the picture. I can't seem to find it right now, but we'll carry on. So we get to the towards the end, and of course, they're going to go up against them. One final battle, one final push, right? And what do we see here?
Gives Saw a nice kiss, and she's like, just in case.
Yeah, just in case. Kind of foreshadowing kind of one of the sadder points of the story, right? And when
just in case happened.
Yeah, right. And this was the introduction too of the droid gunship also. That was pretty impressive.
That was one of the cooler toys that we got in the Clone Wars collection. I really liked that.
Yeah, I just acquired one, which is really great. I've been fortunate to have just a really great friend share some of his collection with me. So I really am getting close to having pretty much everything from the Clone Wars line. And it really was impressive. You know, we're not saying by making all this stuff that they didn't do a great job. They did a really great job.
They did.
There's so much.
I mean,
yeah, that we really,
they put out from this show is amazing.
What's that?
The amount of vehicles that we got from the show is just amazing.
Oh, tell me about it. Yeah, I know. The droid, the ball droid, and the gunships, and all the different things. The
Octoparo droid.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So we're in the midst of the battle, and what happens? Saul gets excited, or he gets radical, like he is. Saul is radical, right? And he uses those weapons that Hondo brought. And what does he do? He takes down that droid gunship.
The last one, and it crashes into Steela's position.
Exactly.
It seems like it's down and it's not working anymore.
Yeah.
It kind of awakens at the wrong time.
So yeah. What happened was it hit like the cliff, and Steela's up there with King Dendup, and they think they're safe, but then like the cliff like cracks and Steela throws King Dendup like up to safety, and then she takes the fall and then like just barely holds on. And then Lux tries to grab her, he falls too, and then they're both kind of hanging on, and then Ahsoka runs over to lift them both up. She gets Lux, and then when she goes to get Steela,
yeah,
the droid gunship kind of like activates a little bit and shoots her right in the arm, and she drops. That's the end.
Yep. And you know, you would have thought that two things that I always do in the Clone Wars, I was like, oh, this is the moment when they're going to kill Ahsoka off.
I know, right?
Every time.
Yeah, a lot of those.
Yeah, go ahead.
No, there's a lot of those moments where you thought Ahsoka was done for.
I know. It became.
It was a tease.
In a weird way, it became kind of a running joke because you see it all the way in the beginning, you know, from season one all the way up to season five. You know, you're like, oh, they're killing her off because that thing, like, goes right through her shoulder. And I'm just like, oh, my God.
Yeah, you think it's going to go right through her heart and keep going out the front.
Yeah, and I was just like, you're on the edge of your seat because here we're literally seeing that.
They even silenced the scene. When she drops Steela, like, everything goes quiet and everybody's like, what just happened? What's happening?
Yeah, I was just shocked. I didn't expect to see any. I wasn't expecting to see any major characters pass away. That really came as a surprise in the episode.
Yeah, there was a lot of surprises in this entire arc, right? The whole Saul is my brother, Steel is my sister. You know, let's have this love triumph between Lux and Ahsoka and Steela, right? And, you know, Kalani calculating, doing all the different calculations, the first reveals, you know, with the super tactical droid, and of course the gunships that we were just talking about, and all the different things that kind of went along with the episode. But in the end, they decided to align with the Republic again, right?
Yeah.
And kind of a little fun fact for our Rebels friends, later on down the road, Onderon obviously gets taken over again because the Empire happens, right?
Yeah.
And Onderon is the place where the whole, Agent Kallus goes and has that meetup with the Lasat that kills his entire group.
That happens?
Yeah, it happens on all the Onderon. Yeah.
Ooh, I didn't realize that.
Yeah, and that Lasat, that crazy Lasat that spared his life or whatever, spared Kallus' life, was part of Saul's group. You know?
Wow, that's awesome.
Yeah. And, of course, Lux, too, he decides he's going to lead all Onderon in his mother's place. Yes.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, so yeah, there was a lot of surprises in this episode. It was really pretty long, but it was very interesting. Everything that kind of came about and what have you, right?
Yeah, just it reinforced the whole forbidden love between Ahsoka and Lux, and you know, you get to a point where you're like, all right, that's a closed chapter. Lux is moving on with Steela. Then Steela dies. Then you're like, oh, all right, well, maybe there is hope for that relationship. But then Ahsoka is really kind of the one who dropped her. And you can't really continue a relationship going like, oh, yeah, I'm the one who killed your last girlfriend by accident, you know.
Yeah.
So reinforced that in love.
Yeah, I thought that Saul was going to kind of blame her for that. But he took responsibility right away. You knew that he was going to accept it eventually.
That was something that kind of made him the radical kind of guy he was. He kind of like, even in Rebels, again, watch Rebels. It's so great. There's so many ways it ties in. But like when we meet Saw, he carries around like a little hologram of Steela with him. Like he really took the blame for what happened to Steela and it messed him up for the rest of his life.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree with that. He had some demons. That guy had some demons, you know. And
which just, I think is cool that we got to see that part of Saw's life, considering that, like, you know, most Star Wars fans, they're going to think of Saw Gerrera. They're going to think of the Saw Gerrera from Rogue One. They're not going to think Rebels. They're not going to think Clone Wars, because it's a different kind of Star Wars fan that watches that animated content and watches the films. Like, the casual Star Wars fan may not have ever even seen one episode of any of the animated stuff. So it's really cool that, you know, this movie character for, is probably the Saw Gerrera everybody will know. We got a more intimate look at that character and his beginnings and his family. And it's really cool that Star Wars operates in that way now.
Yeah, as far as fandom goes, I always thought that it was the next thing. It was the next evolution in Star Wars fandom. You know, episode 3 ends and you're like, oh, Star Wars ends. I'm like, no, it's not. Here's this animation. Let's go watch it and let's take it on and just make let's be a fan of it also. That's where my fandom comes from, because I know it was your son's it was essentially his Star Wars, but it was really special for me also. You know, I really enjoy the Clone Wars, just animation in general. I like animation. And yeah, I didn't think they could ever do it in live action though. You know, there's no way they could have, made as much, this immersive, right?
Yeah, I would have liked to see Dark Disciple as a live action.
That would be cool. Maybe they could still do that, you know, maybe an arc or something like that.
Yeah.
But not the whole Clone Wars, but...
No, I know, yeah, I would agree.
I think it's something people really should watch, because it connects to the story as a whole. It makes it better.
Yeah. You know,
another one of our favorite characters that's not in here, that's just like Saw Gerrera, is Bo-Katan. You know, we're constantly raving about her, and we want her as a figure just because she's in the Clone Wars. She's in Rebels. Was she in Forces of Destiny? I think she was even in.
I think she was. I think she had something.
But she's going to be in the new Clone Wars. And Hasbro, you need to
know. I have a feeling she'll probably even get mentioned in some way, shape, or form in The Mandalorian, maybe.
I know. It's like,
could be Mandalorian history at this point.
If they brought her in, you know, like an old, you know, battle-worn Bo-Katan, face melt. Like, again, face melt. Just,
I know, right?
like the Darth Maul in Solo, you know. But I love that kind of stuff. I love those different types of things, but we've carried on long enough. That is our episode, of course, for this time around, episode 70. When I am not here, I am at Peak-OB1 Custom Creations on Facebook. You can also find me on Instagram at Peak-OB1 Custom Figures. Please follow me. I very much appreciate it. I'm just a fan of Star Wars and customizing and all kinds of great things that go along with it. Where can we find you when you're not here?
Best place to get us would be on the Customs for the Kid blog. That's customsforthekid.blogspot.com. Also, you'll be able to catch us on Facebook, YouTube, Instagram, Twitter, and Tumblr, and we also have some things located on Pinterest.
Nice. Awesome. Well, thank you for joining us, friends. We'll see you next time. May the Force be with you. Take care.
Take care, everybody. May the Force be with you.
Always.